may be more infamous than famous. I'm Lyle Johnstone. I've lived in this area, either Jerome or Twin Falls, for 60-plus years. I'm married to my lovely Miss Debbie, almost 41 years. We have three boys that have grown up to be fine young men. So why am I in this thing? Friends of mine say you have got to have lost your mind to get in that pigsty in Boise. And I said, well, you may go in my stead, but what I'm doing is watching the voting tally, scoring of votes for people. So I'll park that for a second. One of the things that offends me the most is to be deceived or lied to. I despise it. I get 2-year-old, 3-year-old kids to it, right? But we train them up not to do that. So I see people who put their name tag on as a Republican, and they vote like a Democrat, and it angers me to. So that's why I'm in this race. So my goal is to try and move back to a constitutional republic as it was written, not the monkey business that we see today going on with it. I'm one guy, I'm one vote, I'm not the king. I don't want to be the king. I want to be the representative of the people who run the government. So if we go to the Gettysburg Address, it is by the people, for the people, of the people. So we have people like Miss Christy Zitto who do that job. I mean, they represent the people. It's government from the bottom up. We have had 6 elected officials in the Magic Valley, districts 24 and 25, that are supposed to be constitutional Republicans. Republic, as in the Constitution. The definition of the thing is conservatism. And they go to Boise, and they're scored as the best ones as C's. Most of them are D's and F's. That's really troubling to me. So I can look south and west of here. I can look west of here. I can look northwest of here. And what I see is liberalism that is ruining economies and people's lives. That's where we're going to be in a few years if we don't turn this thing around and head the boat the other direction. So that's why I'm in it. I'm not there for the title. I don't need to be called honorable, the good gentleman from 25. That's not my point. My point is to, in essence, before it comes down to blood and bullets, we go through this Revolutionary War and turn it back to what the founding fathers believed it to be. God's always on top. God's the reason we have the nation structure that we have. Lots of younger people have told me that it doesn't work. Look at it, it's a mess, it doesn't work. Capitalism doesn't work. So I'm working on being 61 years old. I've never seen true capitalism. I've never seen a true constitutional republic in my 61 years. I've seen versions of it. So we can't say that the government doesn't work as it's designed because we don't run it as it was designed. We made a mess out of it. So that's why I'm in the race. There are issues that we gotta work with, right? And so there are some factions of people that don't work through issues, they just argue. And some things are hard to sell. They're hard to come to an agreement of what they are. But there's always truth at the bottom of the pile, if you'll just dig down to where the truth's at. I know where the ultimate truth's at. It's in the Word. And from almost every precept in the Bible, man can solve almost every defugal duty that he has in civil government. But we gotta sit down at the table like this trespass thing, and we gotta work through it with calmer heads and calmer hearts. I am a property owner, a little house. I have been a farm property owner. I get trespass. People are sinners. I mean, thou shalt not commit murder. Murder is a felony, right, Judge?
Yeah, correct, it is.
So we have the ultimate law from God. We have the law from man. It's a felony to murder. People murder, right? I'm not saying that we just allow whatever to run amok, but what I'm saying, people are sinners. So that's a messy part of life, and we have to deal with it. How do we deal with it? So we buck up the bucks, we make it more expensive. And the people who were supposed to be taking care of it with the badge and maybe even from the bench. I don't know what happens when it gets to the bench, okay? It's got to be dealt with, and it's got to be dealt with rightly. We can't sit at the bench and kick it off and laugh about it because it's serious from the landowner's perspective. Some of those violations, even in that, are obvious. If it's irrigated and fenced and throw crop, if that's a, okay, you got to be a bonehead and you're just bound on breaking the law. It's like committing murder. It's against all natural law that I'm going to do it anyway. Okay? So, what I want to do, I'm a small guy, I'm a low tax kind of guy. I'm one guy. Work with the 10 or 12 people who are already on that mission. And the shift is changing in Boise. It's a little bit, but it's changing. So if we can continue to put constitutional Republican type small government people in there, we can continue to move that the right direction. So that's the basis of why I have all the answers, and I'll have all the solutions. But we got to sit down at the table sometimes and work through some give and take and how to. It's not right for people to be wrong. It just isn't. So that's who I am. Most of you know who I am already, so I'm preaching to the choir. So if you've got questions, I'll be glad to try and answer them. Fire away, Mr.
So I have a question on the trespass thing as well. So with the three strikes thing, could we say that as if we trust in our judicial system, can we give the bench the and actually it might even be better to have a jury of peers have to issue one of those strikes that goes towards your three strikes? Would that be a better way to go about that, as where it's not being a government entity that's trying to take away your what right, but it's a quorum of your peers that eventually would be deciding that you no longer have the rights of normal citizens?
Yeah, I mean, I get it from being a farm owner. What often happens is it gets sloughed off, and that's what I'm hearing. I mean, I'm hearing it from landowners. So what's happening in those processes? I don't know. You know, I have a friend that he and I, a couple of months ago, had this heated debate, and he's like, I should never have to post any of it, even if it's up against federal land. That's your problem, and you figure it out. So he'll still vote for me, but we still don't agree on the issue. So it needs worked out. I don't know. I get that 25 and 50 bucks isn't enough in today's world. Your comment was valid. There's people with lots deeper pockets than mine that can just like 25 bucks on fire and it's not a big deal, I don't care, you know. So that's part of the problem. And I guess we could get to a point of it becoming a felony. I don't like the way the felony thing reads right now. That's, so would you please, Mr. Booth, give me a judiciary definition of a felony, typically a felony crime?
Well, I don't know if I know the law dictionary definition off the top of my head, but typically felonies are the more serious crimes, misdemeanors are the
So when we talk serious, what kind of serious? I mean, a level of serious.
Okay, well, starting with, you know, premeditated murder, rape, kidnapping. I mean, those are kind of the typical felonies, but...
Okay. I mean, I guess, so a major bank robbery could be a felony.
Correct. Property crimes, there's... Typically, bank robberies fall under federal jurisdiction, but
right.
Yeah, there's property crimes. There's a dollar limit, and if you go over that dollar limit of damage, it typically becomes a felony.
So if you haven't gathered up on that, I'm not a legal aficionado, but I think what a lot of us see that are outdoor recreationists, I don't want to wrong anybody. I don't want to trespass on their property on purpose. Don't want to be a felon because I didn't murder or rape or do any serious injury to anybody, okay? So that there seems to be two parts to that. There's a civil trespass, right? And then a more injurious, I don't remember what the language is.
Well, if it's in the definition, it'll say that they should have known or should have had reason to know that they were trespassing.
Mm-hmm. Put more teeth in it. Doing. For us 25 people, this is about the fourth-ish forum or public event in almost that many days. So it's a subject that's coming up, and from incumbents, basically, this is what I'm hearing, and I heard it before y'all left the legislature. This wasn't necessary. Read the bill and I'm going, okay, I get it, I understand, I want private property owners protected. So Reese and I, this friend, when we argued about it, he says, well, how about if I come over in your front yard and I back my trailer up and I unload my horses in your front yard? And I said, have you read the statute in the state of Idaho today? And he goes, it doesn't make any difference. I said, well, it does if you're a law-abiding citizen. But what we're talking about, there are people that aren't law-abiding people. They are purposely breaking the law. So how do you, and I'm not trying to be this closed circuit. I'm using this. How do you protect us that we don't end up in their trap, those lawless people? And so I guess that's where we're coming from with the bill. But what I'm hearing incumbents say, it was a bad bill. We probably shouldn't have passed it, but we did pass it, and next year we're going to have to fix it.
Well, just for the record, if I would have thought it was a really bad bill, I would have voted for it.
I get that.
Because I don't
get
that.
Yeah.
I do really question it. And I really just,
It's a tough deal, and we're going to have to solve it, right? Whether we do it as citizens or we do it as legislators, we're going to have to solve the issue. And I'm not trying to discount the landowner. I want them taken care of. But I'm not good with the felony thing yet. It isn't murder. It isn't rape. It isn't a $40 million bank debt.
Because I do have a problem with the fact that possession of, is it, how much marijuana can be a felony?
Over 3 ounces.
And so...
How did I know?
Is that dry?
I don't know. I don't know their weighing.
Yeah. Rocky.
I was curious. Maybe I missed it, but in convinced me that some down to a lot of bites, some bite-sized pieces. Three of the biggest problems that you see facing Idaho right now, and what would be a bite-sized, digestible piece? What would be a quick answer for your idea for a solution to fix them?
I think globalism is the thing we need to watch really close. So it is just a tool to move us into management overall, and then that'll sound like conspiracy theory to the world. But you know, if you're a hunter and you track things, you learn what tracks look like, right? I know the difference between the cat track and the dog track and the deer track. People leave tracks. I mean, I can watch who puts up political signs first, and I can see who's allied to get it, right? So it's a progressive thing. Other things that, what we protect our resources, and our resources in Idaho are huge. That's not a little subject. It is grazing places. It is hiking places. It's horsing places. It's timber. It's gold. It's molybdenum. It's taters. It's soil. It's farm ground. It's water. I mean, all of those resources, we're going to have to protect them, because I guarantee you somebody else would like to sew them up somehow. Right? And God not being on top is a really big one, but education, I think that needs some major, I'm not sure it's education, but it's time in school.
Follow-up question real quick. The cop not managing their lands, we have like 68% of our lands being managed by the federal government, being mismanaged.
Owned, right? I'm not trying to give you a hard time. I'm just saying, let's. Okay, so finish what you're going to say.
What do you think a policy for sure would be in order to hold them accountable? Because realistically, we're not going to be able to push them out right at the beginning, but you have to be able to hold them accountable initially, because it's all about an inch of game, taking inches. So what do you think a policy prescription would be initially to hold them accountable?
So some of the things that I've heard in all of this melee, which sounds good, I don't know what the implementation is. Christy may have some answers. She may have heard some things, but do we take over the management? We can't afford ownership. I mean, so if we're going to do ownership, to me, that looks like, from a simple man's idea, I can work my way through it someday. I don't have the answers today. But let's say it's like buying a house, okay? So I go to the mortgage company, I get the money, I go to the closing company, I get the key, right? I own it now. I go home and I put the key in the door and I unlock it. Can I make the monthly payment, right? Yeah, we can't do that with all the federal lands in the state of Idaho. So think about that. We walk through that door. Where's the manpower? Where's the rolling stock? Where's the equipment? And how do you fight the first major fire? Right? I'm not saying someday we don't want to be there. I'm just saying we can't just put the key in the lock, open the door, and be done with it. Because we can't afford it.
Unless you have cannabis.
So if we grow cannabis and all of it and sell it to California and Oregon, maybe we can. I don't know. And I'm not voting for that. Sorry. But the point.
Why not?
Huh?
Why not? I really
want to
know that one.
Why not? I'm just not there.
You know, this is personal for me. When my mother was dying of cancer back in 79, the one thing that legal in Idaho was passed, the one thing over morphine or any other drug dealer that gave her some peace for maybe an hour was marijuana.
So why not
let these people have it? Why is this such a big deal? It's no worse than it's no worse than alcohol. Marijuana, and I've never smoked it, never plan on doing it, but it's no worse than alcohol.
So that's an opinion from what I see, but anyway. I'm not so sure that I'm against medical, okay? I'm not up to the free open market system of it. I'm good with CBD oil. I think that was a travesty deal this year. So, I forgot where we're going now. You train wreck me. You said why not. You said why not.
We just
can't afford to own Idaho lands yet. Do I wish we owned them and we controlled them and we're not going to sell them all off and end up like Texas and you have to lease a place to go hunt? No. But the other reason.
Since I picked on everybody else, okay. I had thought for a long time to come up with this question. I didn't have one. What do you think about administrative rule and how do you think it affects the everyday citizen and person?
I'm not clear what administrative rule is.
So administrative rules is what the government uses to regulate you. It has the same effect as law, but doesn't have the same requirements as law. So let's say...
You're talking about kingship?
More or less.
So am I a constitutional guy?
Possibly.
Well, you have to trust me in that, right? So, I am a constitutional guy, so I don't believe in kingship.
So it's not so much kingship as it basically gives the government the right to tell you what you can and can't do, and you have zero recourse. For instance, the EPA comes in, you're doing something on your property. They go, you can't do that. They shut you down. They fine you. It takes you 3 years to get a judicial review to have that reversed. It doesn't matter. They're right. All that matters is they applied that rule properly.
And you're sitting in jail the whole time they're doing it, right?
Very well could be.
That's right.
It very well could be. Every government agency uses administrative rule for everything. It's something that should be designed to regulate the government and not the people. And it's just been reversed. It was made to make the government's job easy. I see a use for it. I see a need for it. But
so I think part of how we got to where you're at is a couple of things. The government... federal government level wants control.
Exactly.
Okay. And one of the other things that's happened through not properly operating a constitutional republic, and Ms. Christie can get me straightened out here if I get off base. So when we look at Congress, okay, we're talking Washington, D.C., and we can get there in Idaho, I think, too, but what's happened in Washington, D.C. is the Senate and the House have both purposely given away their power to make legislation. Okay, so if we look at the Constitution, the way I understand it, Article 1 makes up about 52 or 3% of the total Constitution. And Article 1 is about who? The lawmakers, the Senate and the House, right? So Article 2 is about the administration, and it makes up something like about 28%. So the administration, the presidency, or the governor doesn't get to make law. The rest of it is given to the judiciary, which is about 8%, who runs this country today, more or less. So Congress has given away its ability to write law and, we'll say, control the people, control what goes on in the people mass, right? And they've given it to department heads. Now we have the EPA making rules. So a lot of us for years have said the IRS makes up its own rules and it enforces its own rules. And then you have to go to court to fight the IRS, which is in essence what has happened in a lot of governmental administrative agencies. They make the rules. We're stuck with the leftovers. And who do we hold responsible? Well, we don't vote Harry Reid out or Mike Simpson because they didn't do it. They should have been doing it. So people would or wouldn't be mad at them for doing it or not doing it, and then we vote them out of office. Now they just sit around and say, yeah. So how do we get that back in spec, right?
I see one big problem that I don't know what the solution is, but it's our own fault that we are where we are. Mm-hmm. Because as I go around knocking on doors and talking to people, they don't care. And when you have, I don't know how many thousand votes in Twin Falls, and somebody can win their seat with 1,000 votes, something's wrong. And we can't change it if people don't care. So my problem is, how do we change that? What do we do? Somehow, we the people group or whatever, we need to get big enough where we're reaching out and holding people accountable. You know, everybody wants to gripe, but it's everybody's fault because they don't pay any attention. They send whoever...
Take away their Netflix and their cell phone.
Right, and whoever promises them the most stuff, oh good, we'll send them.
I just gave Christy a really bad taste of the heartburn.
So as far as I see it, that's our basic biggest problem right now.
We need to, all of us, the biggest challenge that I think we have, and I tell me that on state level, is the bureaucratic agencies have become the fourth estate of government, even more so than the judiciary has. And it's justified because when the state legislature passes a law, we need law enforcement, we need police officers, or we need the big excuses we need to do EC, because if we don't, then the EPA will step in, but we fall under purview of both of them. But whatever, whichever bureaucratic agency it is, it felt like that needs to be, that agency needs to be developed, and that's developed by the executive branch of the government to execute what the legislative branch of the government has decided needs to happen. But the problem that you have there is your bureaucratic agencies are staffed and manned and headed by appointees from the executive branch. And so then what happens is they make these rules so that they can apply the things that the legislature wants to see happen. And yes, there needs to be rules so that they know what they can do and how they can do it and how it can happen. But my problem with the rulemaking process is I didn't get this until this year. And in the post under God.
Mm-hmm.
And I unfortunately just happened to be the poor sad person that caught that. They were trying to take that out of the rule.
Mm-hmm.
They were going to take those words out. Yeah, I was reading it along in those rule things, and I went to Ron Nick. They can't say, Ron, did you see this? And he said, no, I didn't see it. But we saw it. So each domain committee goes over the rules for, like, mm-hmm. the judiciary and rules. We do the post and stuff, you know, right. Law enforcement. So we rejected that rule change, that had to stay in the post.
Right.
But what I didn't know, and what very many of us didn't know, is, okay, so judiciary and rules and House of Representatives rejected that rule change. It went to the Senate, and the Senate did not reject that rule change. So that rule change is made. Then we make a law, it has to go through committee to the floor, mm-hmm. and then it has to go to the other side, through committee.
So if it passes the House, then it has to go to the Senate and go through the same process.
Right. Then you have a law that has effect on your life. Rules don't have to do that. It can either pass in the House or in the Senate, and they don't need to be signed by the governor, but they still have to effect the law on your life.
So, ideas? How do we deal with that as we the people, not just as you the legislator, right?
Kind of in the way we kind of got triggered
mm-hmm.
with HJR
sure.
5,
sure.
the constitutional amendment that makes it so that, and in a way it's good because it did codify and make it constitutional, but those rules have to be reviewed.
Mm-hmm.
So now what we've got to do is we've got to look at how do we fix that process
mm-hmm.
so that they're going to have the full time effect of law in your life. It has to be passed on at least both sides of your agenda. I don't necessarily think that the governor needs to sign. Do you know the education rules that they had to review in district this year? Just here. That was an education. And help them
not,
with all, almost that
not quite, but
not,
almost the size of the omnibus bill.
And that's not every rule. They do a third of the rules every year.
Wow. We need more rules.
Yeah. Sure.
Right? So I think part of what we need, i.e. education, is almost like a small business full audit. Where does the money go? Right? So we're paying, so one of my children, adult children, brought up to me the other day. So we have friends who are teachers. I mean, they're making $32,000 a year, and you're talking about 63% of the main budget goes into education. You're talking $2.1
billion.
B, not million, billion.
And that's right? Not everything either.
No, right. Then we pass local levies on top of that, right? So where does the money go? I mean,
if you go on Transparent Idaho, it's part of the controller's office website.
Okay.
It's called Transparent Idaho. And there's a place that's the people who make more than the governor.
Right.
So you click on that and you open it up, like the first six pages are university administration. And so you appropriate all this money, but it's not given into our classroom.
Exactly.
And that's our challenge. Is
right. How do,
you know,
how do we fix that?
Well, and we need to be constitutional, because constitutionally we're only mandated to take care of education, to provide common education, is what we've done in the Constitution. Mm-hmm. So that takes you at least grade, sometimes 12, if you look at the definition for that period of time. And then our agricultural university. The rest of it, we're not constitutionally mandated to take care of. Mm-hmm. And if those dollars, we're 49th in the nation, well, actually we're 50th in the nation right now, what we spend on our kids per child in the classroom, we test out 24. We say, well, 24 is not that bad. But yeah, I mean, who wants to be second best, right?
So if we back up, I don't remember how long, I don't follow it. Quite frankly, don't care. So I'm the odd man out. Okay. But when Coach Pete was at BSU, they were paying him $900,000 a year.
The football coach today makes $1.4 million.
Okay? So we can make whatever kind of excuses we want in the big education thing, okay? We don't got enough money, but I think it's not a case that we don't have enough money, it's that we aren't spending it in the right priorities in this school.
Yeah. Well, I think the problem with education is, you know, it probably started off with a good intention, but like all government programs, they start growing and becoming this beast, and you see where all the money is going to administrative costs. That's a perfect example of how government is non-efficient.
I don't know if there are any administrators in here, but I had a couple of superintendents come to the meeting here, and they said the search, I surveyed not a good word, but I can't think of the word, but the surveys they have to fill out and the redundancy of all of the paperwork, it doesn't tell anybody names in any way, but it's mandated that they have to fill it out. You know, those administrative hours are hours that those administrative students bring back into the classroom. And you know, so.
Yeah. Yeah, it's redundant bureaucracy and paperwork, paper